Let's take another crack at solid hydrogen storage and try to address some of the shortcomings of my last video. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Many are still betting on green hydrogen as an essential piece for fueling the transition to clean mobility and energy storage. And that's especially true for heavy-duty vehicles like buses, trucks, trains, or ships, as well as long-term energy storage. Yet with the current available technologies, creating hydrogen and storing large amounts of it is still tricky and expensive. We need to take a closer look at the metal hydrides that make the storage possible. A metal hydride is formed when hydrogen bonds with a metal. They're sometimes referred to as solid-state hydrogen batteries. The very first metal hydrides date back to the 1930s. However, their energy applications didn't start to solidify until the end of last century. And since the early 1990s, nickel hydrides have been used as rechargeable batteries. A decade later, hydrogen was stored onto intermetallic compounds to work as a stationary backup power unit. So how do these materials work? Well, basically when a hydrogen gas molecule approaches the metal surface, it dissociates or breaks down into two hydrogen atoms. These travel from the metal surface to its internal crystal structure. That's where atomic hydrogen bonds with the metal framework through a process called absorption. To reverse this mechanism and release the hydrogen, you need to heat up the compound, which for some metal hydrides requires high release temperatures, even as high as 300 degrees Celsius or 572 degrees Fahrenheit. At those temperatures, it's not exactly an energy-efficient process to release the hydrogen. Sometimes it's referred to as solid hydrogen, even though it's the metal structure that's the solid. Now, the hydrogen atoms are small enough to fit between the lattice of the metal structure, meaning that they can sit between the metal lattice atoms. Regardless of the bonding mechanism, in order to free the hydrogen from this bond, heat has to be added to give it enough energy to slip free and then diffuse through the lattice, back out of the metal, and into a gaseous form. It's a lot to take in. So what about at a practical level? How does solid hydrogen stack up against conventional storage techniques, like compressing it or liquefying it? One of the main advantages of metal hydrides is that they can store hydrogen at much lower pressure compared to gas tanks, where hydrogen is kept up to about 10,000 PSI, or about 700 bar. The only way to withstand such high pressure without having super heavy cylinders is to reinforce the vessels with something like carbon fiber. It's a very safe system, but it often is cost prohibitive. Now, liquefaction is another way to store hydrogen that doesn't require high pressure. The drawback with liquefaction is that you need to keep the liquid hydrogen in a cryogenic vessel to minimize evaporation at negative 252 degrees Celsius or about 423 degrees Fahrenheit. And just like the high heat for releasing hydrogen from some forms of metal hydrides, this is an energy-expensive process. It also doesn't fully prevent hydrogen from boiling off. Instead, metal hydrides can work for a long time without losing any hydrogen. And despite a much higher capital cost, binding hydrogen with a metal framework may work out as a cheaper storage solution in the long run. That's what the Department of Energy concluded when comparing operation and maintenance costs of different hydrogen storage technologies. They pegged metal hydride storage at about 2 cents per kilowatt hour versus compressed gas and liquid hydrogen at 4 cents and 6 cents per kilowatt hour. Energy density is another essential factor to look at when comparing storage options, especially when considering small size vehicles. Small cars can't carry bulky, heavy storage units. You need something that can store a lot of energy per unit of weight and volume to maximize the driving range. This is why technology with a high energy to weight and volume ratio, like lithium-ion batteries, are the preferred solution for light-duty consumer electric vehicles. With all of this in mind, here's one of the things I should have explained better in my last video: the difference between gravimetric and volumetric energy density. Now let's take two identical plastic bottles. If you see the amount of water in each one of them as energy, which kind of is in a way, when you fill them up to the same level, the two bottles have the same volumetric density. However, if one of the two bottles were made of a metal, this would have a lower gravimetric energy density than the lighter plastic bottle. When it comes to storing hydrogen, the universal rules still apply. From a gas to a liquid to a solid, you go from the least dense to the most dense. So a liquid can save you a lot of space compared to a gaseous phase. Even when the gas is compressed at the highest practical pressure, which is about 700 bar, hydrogen gas has a volumetric density of only 40 kilograms per cubic meter. This falls short of liquid hydrogen's 70 kilograms per cubic meter. However, when considering aluminum or magnesium hydrides, the volumetric hydrogen density balloons through the 80 kilograms per cubic meter threshold. So why is that? The reason is linked to how you create metal hydrides. As I mentioned earlier, before hydrogen bonds with a metal core, its molecule dissociates into two atoms. These are then tightly packed into the metallic structure, which results in a high hydrogen to metal ratio for most complexes. I had a chance to speak to Dr. Brandon Wood from Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, who backed this up.
The advantage of a metal hydride is that you form a direct chemical bond between hydrogen and something else. And that allows you, literally to compact the hydrogen in much closer than you could, even with a liquid.
But how close are we talking about?
Angstroms apart. as opposed to what you have in a liquid or a gas, which is much larger than that.
And that's true even when factoring the space taken up by the metal hydride framework.
This is not a matter of debate. It's just a scientific fact. You get something in a solid phase, and it's generally speaking more compact than it is in a liquid, and even if you pay the dead weight for the matrix host.
Yet metal hydrides have a relatively low energy density by weight. And for this reason, a tank filled up with metal hydrides is about 4 times heavier than a gasoline tank. Obviously, this is not a great solution for cars in comparison to other technologies that are available today. However, they could be a cost-effective option as a stationary energy source where you don't care about the weight. Also, they'd be an advantage when storing hydrogen on heavy-duty EVs. For instance, industrial machines like forklifts need heavy counterweights to balance the heavy loads that they carry. And with no high pressure, the factor of safety required to design new tanks is greatly reduced. All of this reduces the costs and is another selling point for solid hydrogen. And some of the more vocal critics of my last video approach metal hydrides in general as a fantasy or a fool's errand. So let's make sure we're not living in a fantasy land and look at the real world. Have these materials been used successfully for hydrogen storage? Yes. Working as a storage unit for a fuel cell, metal hydrides have been propelling some German submarines since 2003. As you can imagine, extra weight is a bonus rather than a limitation in that case, as submarines need to carry a lot of counterweight to stay underwater. With a price tag of $500 million, a fuel cell costs as much as a diesel submarine. When equipped with a metal hydride storage unit, fuel cell submarines can run underwater for up to 14 days. That's much longer compared to the max of 2 days for a battery hybrid submarine. ThyssenKrupp Marine Systems, who was the first to dive into this field, released their fourth generation fuel cell just 2 years ago. How about something a little closer to home? Hystorsis AS, I think that's how you say their company name, is a spin-off of the Norwegian Institute for Energy Technology, and they have a unit that can be mounted on a wall, like in your home. Besides standalone solutions, their technology called HIMEC, I think that's how you say the acronym, can also be a power backup for industrial sites. The storage unit of this thermally driven system is a vessel filled with a metal alloy powder. The powder has more surface area, speeding up the diffusion of the hydrogen into the lattice. When absorbing the hydrogen onto it, they cool the unit down to 15 degrees Celsius, which is about 59 degrees Fahrenheit, and while heating it up to 95 degrees Celsius, or about 203 degrees Fahrenheit, to release the gas. HIMEC is currently used in an off-grid house in combination with renewables and other storage solutions. Now, this is not the only home solution. In Australia, the company Lavo has a Tesla Powerwall-like device that uses metal hydrides too. The global organization GKN is also working on a similar use case. Their engineers formulated a new metal alloy powder and compacted it into pellets. These allow for a more dense hydrogen storage solution compared to compressed gas tanks. The system's working pressure when capturing hydrogen is 20 times less than typical pressurized vessels. To withdraw hydrogen, you just heat the material up to 65 degrees Celsius, which is significantly lower than the 300 degrees Celsius that I mentioned earlier. With a storage capacity of 50 kilowatt hours per 100 kilograms of metal hydride, GKN pellets are on par with the lithium-ion battery used in a Tesla Model 3. You can use clean electricity to power an electrolyzer, which generates green hydrogen and stores it in their metal hydride. This way, they can store hydrogen for months if needed, until feeding it into a fuel cell to generate electricity on the way back out. They started a pilot in 2019 using their technology as a winter power backup for an off-grid house in the Alps. By recovering the waste heat, GKN systems achieve a round-trip efficiency of 90%, which is about the same as a typical lithium-ion battery. They've also integrated the system into a hot water heater setup to get some extra use out of that thermal heat. Based on their company white paper, their solid hydrogen storage technology becomes more cost-effective for capacities higher than 80 kilowatt hours. Just this October, GKN received $1.7 million of funding from the U.S. Department of Energy to test the scalability of their storage system. 2 9-megawatt-hour units will be connected to a megawatt-scale electrolyzer and fuel cell facility. And that leads me to the elephant in the hydrogen room, which has nothing to do with metal hydrides, and that's cost and efficiency. When you consider the combination of power to hydrogen and hydrogen to energy, you achieve a max round-trip efficiency of only about 46%. This is still far from more mature technologies like pump storage hydropower, which delivers up to 85% of the electricity stored. Based on a Volkswagen study, power losses along the hydrogen fuel chain translate into an efficiency of about 35% for hydrogen-powered electric cars in the best-case scenario, which is less than half of what you get for battery electric vehicles on average. Now, efficiency isn't the only roadblock. Cost is a major driving factor regardless of efficiency. Gasoline is much cheaper to make, mostly because of the low cost of crude oil, accounting for 53% of its production fees. Adding up taxes, transportation, and refinery costs, gasoline price at the pump is about $3.30 a gallon on average right now. Instead, with the current technologies, you need nearly twice as much to produce 1 gallon of gasoline equivalent of hydrogen. It's the 1-2 punch of efficiency and cost that make hydrogen a tough sell in the automotive industry. it's not just the lower round-trip efficiency on its own. Which brings me back to metal hydrides. As hydrogen technologies like electrolyzers, fuel cells, and storage systems improve, the overall efficiency will increase and the costs drop. Metal hydrides could make much more sense than other technologies like batteries when it comes to longer-term storage systems, and I'll let Dr. Wood explain why.
If you think about a battery, if you want to double the capacity of your battery, you need to double, you basically need two identical cells. Batteries tend to be very heavy. They're never going to get super lightweight just because the chemistry that's associated with the cathode in a battery requires heavier elements. So you double the capacity of the battery, you double its weight, and you double its volume. That's not true for hydrogen because the only thing you need to double is the storage tank. You don't need to double the fuel cell stack. So with a small fuel cell stack and a gigantic storage tank, you can get all the advantages of multiplying by 10 the capacity of a standard battery without any of the weight limitations that you would get from that.
Back in 2019, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory estimated that hydrogen tanks coupled with fuel cells were more cost-effective than batteries when storing energy for more than 13 hours. Also, in a more recent study, researchers compared the levelized cost of energy of the major long-duration energy storage technologies at different discharge times. Not surprisingly, lithium-ion batteries were one of the cheapest solutions for 12-hour discharge. Yet combining underground hydrogen storage with a heavy-duty fuel cell turned out to be even more competitive for a 5-day duration. The end result is that the viability of solid hydrogen depends on your use case. There's a lot of research and predictions around the levelized cost of hydrogen and where it's projected to go over the coming decades. Metal hydrides are already a solid reality for fueling heavy-duty mobility like submarines, as well as ensuring the energy autonomy of remote households. However, storage is only one of the pieces of the hydrogen puzzle. We also need to achieve more cost-effective fuel production and power conversion. As with all of my videos, I always include a link to the script with all the citations and sources that you can check out for more information, and that's down in the description. And even though this update is twice the length of my previous video and gave far more context around solid hydrogen, I'm still just scratching the surface here. It's part of the reason why it took me and my team so long to pull this one together. Just like all of my videos, this isn't meant to be the definitive, comprehensive source of knowledge, or calling a technology a success or a scam. It's just a jumping off point. Things have to get boiled down to fit my usual 10 to 12 minute long video and be understandable for a larger audience. It's a challenge that all science and technology YouTube channels struggle with. In fact, Chris Scott put out a video not too long ago called "We Lied to You and We'll Do It Again." It's definitely worth watching. Now, I'm still learning this stuff and always trying to improve, and for all the people that gave me constructive criticism, thank you. So what do you think of solid hydrogen? Do you think it will play a role in the future of energy storage? Jump in the comments and let me know. And let's keep the debate respectful. And if you have knowledge on this or work in the industry, please share your experiences so we can all learn more together. And thanks as always to my patrons. All of your direct support really helped with producing these videos and to reduce my dependence on the YouTube algorithm. And speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. And subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.